Hey, welcome back to the Personality Hacker Podcast. My name is Joel Mark Witt.
And I'm Antonia Dodge.
We are continuing to talk today in what is emerging as a short little series around relationships, falling in love. And today we want to talk a little bit about this idea of finding the right person for yourself. Finding Mr. or Miss Right. You know, finding that person that you're going to be in relationship with. I was speaking to a friend of mine, a female friend of mine who's around 25 years old. And so she's a millennial and she's happily married. She's in a marriage relationship. But I was asking her about some of her female friends. And I was just trying to get a sense of what is it that women in her demographic that aren't married yet, that aren't in, you know, long committed relationships yet, what is it that they're looking to? What is it that they see as their path to relationship, romance, falling in love? How do they interpret this? And as we got talking, a couple of things emerged from the conversation. One was, and this is again just for her and her experience of her friends, so I don't know if this is again all young people at this age group, but what I understood from her and her friends, their conversations, her friends have a very idealistic viewpoint of what their relationships are going to be. This very almost one-size-fits-all relationship. When they find the right person, you know, in this case, they're females that are looking for men. So when they find Mr. Right, quote unquote, this is going to be the epic relationship. This is going to be this amazing love-bonded relationship, this ideal. And that was one theme that emerged from it. And I was asking her questions like, well, are they seeing that show up? Are they seeing that relationship coming to them? Are they finding that they have the potential for that? And we got talking a little bit more, and she was saying, well, they tend to see a lot of the men that come in and out of their lives as not qualified for that. They're not necessarily the high enough quality. They'll maybe casually date them for a short period of time, but they're not going to fit into that uber relationship. I said, well, really, what's going on there? Why is it that there's a disconnect? They have this idealized version of what their relationship is going to be, but they can't seem to get there. There seems to be some type of a block. And she said, well, it might come down to a couple things. The one is that a lot of people that she sees as her peers in her age group don't necessarily either know how to or don't want to put a lot of effort into relationships. So if it doesn't work out quickly, they abandon ship. So if things aren't clicking right away, there's again this kind of Hollywood notion that love happens to you. It's not something you build or it's not something you work toward. It's something that happens. So it's almost like they cut and run if there's any tension or any kind of conflict. Again, this is just this person's experience with their friends. And then the second thing that emerged was this notion that they couldn't find the right guy because how they saw themselves was someone that is really developed, someone that knows what they want, knows who they are, is centered. And the men that are coming into their lives are, you know, flighty or they're not committing or maybe they're jerks or there's a bunch of various reasons why it's not working out. But these men just aren't high quality enough to match them at their quality level, how they see themselves. And so we got talking through that to a degree. And I said, do you think, would it be your opinion that all these young women have arrived at what you would consider fully developed and really present to, you know, to attract the man they desire into their life? And she said, no, I could see they might have some more work to do, but they may not be self-aware around that. They might not really know there's some work to do. And I was thinking in terms of, and I talked to a guy friend of mine, talking about guys, and it's kind of the same thing for some guys, for some men who are seeking women in that arrangement, to say that they see themselves as kind of centered and have it together, and the women coming in their lives are flighty and don't have it together, and they can't seem to form a bond there. And I was like, this is really weird. If both sides of this coin, and again, we're talking about heterosexual relationships here, just for the sake of talking about this in this conversation, but if both sides of the heterosexual relationship see themselves as, hey, I'm okay, I got it all together, I need a man or a woman on the other side of the equation to come and meet me where I'm at because I'm awesome, but I just can't find any quality out there. If everybody's having the experience, then what's going on in this arrangement? Like, what is actually the dynamic here? And then it also complicates it too, as I was talking to these young millennials, a few other young millennials, they were talking about how it's very rare to see some young people literally know how to strike up a conversation with another person without some kind of a tool to augment that experience. So for example, the app Tinder, it's a social media app where you can basically, people in your proximity or people that you've selected through different filters can come into your awareness and you swipe left or right based on your attractiveness toward them. A lot of young people in their early 20s, for example, or teenagers are relying upon tools like this in order to basically meet people and connect initially, rather than going up and risking an ego hit of introducing yourself and getting rejected. So it's a way to kind of pre-screen so you know it's not going to be an awkward social interchange. But she said, this one millennial was telling me that she said a lot of people then get fearful around people coming in to approach them or talk to them. They don't know what to do because they haven't built the skill around being able to interact in this way. Now, again, it might be a particular demographic. I'm talking to this young woman and her friends in a particular area here in the United States. But I wonder if this pattern plays out. And I think the thing we want to talk about today, regardless if this is true across all 20-somethings, the thing I think we really want to hone in on today is if you want to attract that partner, the Mr. or Ms. Right into your life, the person that you want to fall in love with and have an amazing relationship with, if that's your goal, which I don't think is a bad goal, I think you, if you want to fall in love with a quality person, what can you do to make sure that can happen? In other words, is it that person? Are you just sifting through a deck of cards to find the ace in the deck of cards? Is there something, do you have any control in the situation? Do you have to wait till the stars align? Is this something that just happens to you like a lightning strike? Or is there something that you can do to find that person in your life? And I thought that'd be a really interesting conversation for us to unpack today.
There's a massive reframe shift when you stop looking for Mr. or Miss Right and start seeing it as becoming Mr. or Miss Right. And I believe, and I don't necessarily think it's just the younger generation, although, as you mentioned, you know, when you're younger, you're more likely to be in a situation where you're looking for your partner, your life partner, if that's something you're looking for. And so we have a tendency to see more information and data come from younger generations. But I think that of all ages, if you're looking for somebody to you know, pair bond with, there still needs to be the shift from looking for that person to becoming that person. And as opposed to, like you said, going through a deck of cards looking for the ace, the question is, how do I become the ace? Because you're going to attract what you've become. And so if you feel like you've arrived and you don't seem to be attracting peers into your life, right? Because you've arrived and you're looking for somebody else who's arrived, but you don't seem to be able to find that person. I think the smartest question isn't, where are those people? The smartest question is, have I arrived? Am I accurate in my assessment of where I'm at and the kind of person that I should be attracting as a peer? For the sake of just sort of lubricating the conversation and making it easier, if you're taking exception to us talking about Miss or Mrs., you know, Miss or Mr. Right, or we started the conversation out with you know, heterosexual relationships, we're gonna speak in the language of, you know, just sort of general assignations, but have this be an open conversation in your mind. Whatever is your gender preference or whatever your sexual preference is, I think it applies no matter who you are and what your preferences are. It's across the board. Becoming the best version of yourself is the best way to attract somebody else that is a peer, right? Like you will attract people at your level. So what is your personal level or your current level? And getting really accurate on that. I think one of the best ways to determine this is to create a list of all of your personal quote unquote requirements in a spouse. And as you list those requirements, I think it becomes very telling of really what level of intimacy are you desiring to play at? And then also, when you pit yourself up against your requirement list for a spouse, are you matching them? Like, you need to be matching every requirement you have for somebody else. It is unfair to ask that of another person if you haven't yourself reached that level.
I think what you're talking about, making a list of the attributes or the things that are attractive in a mate or somebody you want to attract in your life, whether you want to get married long term or just attract that boyfriend, girlfriend, lover, whatever, you know, arrangement. I think a lot of us, whether it's on a piece of paper, literally, or in our heads, we have like a little list going down. And I would argue that the younger you are, probably the more physical that list is. Not always across the board, but that list is probably very much like eye color, hair color, height, maybe even socioeconomic arrangements. And these things can all be important. Obviously, you want to find the person sexually attractive if you're going to enter into a sexual lover relationship. And I tend to see that the older people get, the more those are still important factors. They're a little bit more open frame, though, often, because the qualities of a person tend to end up on that list a little bit more as someone ages, because it's, they realize that those markers of quote unquote fertility, you know, the sexual attractiveness of somebody is what you're looking for when you're in the very young mating years. Those will eventually all fade anyway. Like, you know, you're 70, 80 years old. You're not going to be young and spry or young and beautiful like you were when you were 20. Like, that's just not going to happen for us as people. So we learn to look for more qualities, qualitative things that are more personality related, aspects of a person that aren't just the physical attributes or the things that come with physical attributes.
And I think as we age, we get more familiar with what we actually find attractive.
Yeah.
Because attraction isn't a choice. So you can make a laundry list of all the physical attributes you have as a requirement to find somebody attractive, and your biology does not care what your brain's laundry list is. Like, you're going to find people attractive that are way off the map from what you think. And as you age, the more you recognize that in yourself and you stop resisting it. I think when you're young, you know, we've got these social constructs of what is currently attractive to us, and we've been so inundated with whatever those images are, and it changes from generation to generation. Like I've noticed that eyebrows are a big deal right now. Oh, eyebrows are super important. And I remember when I was young, eyebrows were super important, but they were like the opposite. People were getting, like, creating pencil thin eyebrows when I was young. And now it looks like everybody's got a couple caterpillars above their eyes now. And that's the marker of attractiveness, is having these nice full eyebrows. And if you have pencil thin eyebrows, well, then that's now definitively unattractive. And when I was a teenager, it was the opposite. If you had caterpillar eyebrows, that was definitively unattractive. And pencil thin eyebrows were very attractive. It's super arbitrary. Neither of these are definitive attractors, right? Like, we need to have eyebrows because we look weird when we don't have them. Some people can get away with it, but most of us look kind of weird when we don't have eyebrows. But what the thickness of those eyebrows is super arbitrary. And I doubt our libido is particularly, you know, like, attached to either one. And maybe that's a thing for some people. Maybe it's a, you know, it's a not a fetish, but a paraphilia. That could be a thing. But for most of us, it's not. So when we get really specific about what we find attractive, over time, we realize that most of those things are rather arbitrary and our libidos don't care. So we can find people attractive that are totally against our physical type, because attraction isn't an option. It's not a choice. It just happens to us. And over time, we stop resisting it, thinking that it says something wrong about us. I think what happens when we find somebody attractive that is against our brain's laundry list, that is our quote unquote type, we resist it because that laundry list of physical attractors, we think says something about who we are. We feel like we're higher quality if our laundry list matches society's, you know, concept of beauty. We want to be the kind of people who find that attractive too, so that society approves of whatever our sexual tastes are. And we actually did a podcast about how our social imprints and our sexual imprints are actually in the same imprint category in our brains, that we're trying desperately to match our sexual imprints to society, but most of us don't have the same imprint. So then we spend our lives hiding our actual sexual preferences. But as we get older, we do that less and less. We don't have to hide what we find attractive. So our laundry list of attractiveness tends to go away because we just step into this reality or this realism, and we give ourselves permission to find more things attractive because we realize we do anyway. So why are we resisting it? It doesn't have to be tall or short or fat or skinny or perfectly manicured, yada yada, or sloppily dressed. Like all these things are really arbitrary to our libido. And once we give ourselves permission to have a broader spectrum of attraction, and it's a permission, it's not training ourselves to find a broader spectrum attractive, it's giving ourselves permission to find a broader spectrum attractive, then we stop having that laundry list.
Yeah, and like for some people, it's also giving themselves permission to own the attraction that it came from within, to say, I'm attracted to this, not, oh, this was this thing outside of myself caused me to be attracted. It was, no, something within me caused me to be attracted to that thing. And I think that's another level of development, being willing to give yourself permission to that as well. At least it's been in my life. So this notion that we as humans go through life looking for, I mean, we want to look for the best mate possible. When you're looking for a relationship, you're not looking for second best or last best. You are looking for the best. You're looking for the person that, you know, again, when you're younger, the physical attributes are important. And assuming baseline, you find the person sexually attractive, because that's kind of the baseline assumption here when you get together with somebody. Let's go ahead and just table that and assume that's the case. the next level up is the other things you're finding attractive. Are you finding them attractive, like what Atodi's talking about, because society tells you those are markers you should have in your life, like these check boxes of, oh, that guy or that girl matches all these criteria that society says a woman or a man needs to match for me to be able to be with them. You know, my friends won't think I'm cool unless the person I'm with matches all these things that they will approve of, quote unquote. Or my buddies won't think I'm high status enough if I don't have the woman that matches all these factors. So there's something to be said for that. And I think that's a whole level of figuring that piece out as you're looking for the person that you're going to be together with. Is it actually the person you desire to be with? Or is it the person that will match all those things so you're cool in front of your friends and society at large? And if you get past that, so assuming you're finding people sexually attractive, you get past the whole, no, this isn't for external markers. Now you're looking for the highest quality person that's your best match. It's the person that you want to spend a significant part of your time with. It's like what we talked about in the last podcast, this love story you want to create. You want to write a love story with this person. It's a person that matters to you to the degree where you're like, you know, I could see us writing notes together, writing a song together, a love song together in our relationship that is something that will affect my life and affect this person's life in a way that individually we wouldn't have in our lives. So it's a really beautiful thing. And that perfect match is what we're looking for. And what's interesting is I think this idea of becoming the right person to attract that match is so powerful. Because if we want that perfect match, we have to become the person. When I say perfect, nothing's perfect. Let me back up. When we get a high quality match, because I don't think there's any a perfect match. Get a high quality match, that probably means that there were two high quality people attracted to each other. And, you know, I've been in a relationship, a marriage before you, Antonia, and it was rough. It was a really bad situation. It was traumatic. And it was very easy in the early days when I got out of this arrangement. It was a very, very difficult and challenging and troubling relationship. Someday I'm going to tell this story about it. And I think people will find it interesting. I think you listening would find it very interesting. But when I got out of that, I think one of the hardest things that I had to realize was whoever I was at the time when I ended up in a relationship with this woman attracted this entire thing into my life. Like, I couldn't attract a better match than who I was at the time. And that's a hard thing to go back and go, wow, like, it's not 100% the other person that ended up kind of being a difficult situation for this relationship I was in. I showed up with a lot of things that attracted that into my life, and realizing the responsibility in that and the things I needed to change. And even now, like in our relationship, like maybe we're in an argument or something, Antonia, and something will come up. You'll say something and I'll let it trigger me the way maybe it did in a past relationship. And I'll find myself responding to you, and I'll have to talk myself, be like, wait a second, is that the kind of person I want to be in this relationship? Because all I'm going to do is I'm going to create a dynamic where I'm going to attract more of that out of you toward me. And so I think of this all the time, in that I will get what I put out. Whatever I put into the relationship with you, Antonia, is what I will also get out of the relationship. And I think it works the same way. What you put into it with me is what you'll get out of it as well. And that's now that we're in a relationship, I think that. But if we weren't in a relationship, I was looking for somebody to be in a relationship with, that's something I'd be thinking a lot about, is I don't know the person that's going to come into my life that is going to be that best match. I can't control that. But I can control who I'm becoming. I can control the qualities that I want to put out in the world that will resonate with the person that will be attracted to those qualities. And I'll be attracted to it in them because it's a value for me as well. And so I think this is just something to think about if you're in the dating scene, if you're looking to attract the mate into your life. This can be powerful in reframing. I'm like what Antonia said, I'm not looking for Mr. Right or Miss Right. I'm looking to become Mr. Right or Miss Right. I want to become the person that when that other resonant entity comes into my field, we just hum together and we just get it. We're instantly attracted and we're bonded and we're connected in a really good match because of who we are and are striving to be better. So I feel like this is a message that I think all of us can hear. And even in the midst of being in a relationship now, it's something you can apply to your life as well. If you're in a troubled relationship, let's say you're already married and you're like, man, my spouse and I, or my lover and I, aren't getting along. Like, we're just having tough times. We're having conflict. What is it that you could become different? How can you scale into becoming even better version of yourself to help move the relationship forward? I think that's a really powerful reframe.
anytime we create a list of requirements for another person, I think at first I really found that idea kind of off-putting. I remember I have an acquaintance. I don't know what her opinion of this is at this time, but about 5 years ago or 7 years ago, I guess it's been a while, I had a conversation with her and she let me know that she had a list of requirements and whoever she was going to be with, I think was it at like 177 items were on the list or something insane like that. It was almost 200 items were on this list of the requirements that she had in whoever she was going to end up with.
Pretty specific, like the exact type of magazine they subscribe to.
Yeah.
And not just the digital version. They have to have actually the physical copy mailed to their house.
Yeah.
Or they're disqualified from being in a relationship with her.
Yeah. And I remember thinking as I heard this laundry list of requirements, do you fear intimacy? Because it kind of sounds like you might fear intimacy. You've created such an unrealistic set of expectations. This doesn't look like you're trying to find the right person. This looks like you're trying to disqualify every person you run into. Do you actually want a relationship? Is that what you want? Or do you think you're supposed to want a relationship? And do you believe that you match all of these requirements? Because some of the requirements, I was looking at the person going like, I don't know if you've even stepped up to the plate. So I sometimes wonder when people have this attitude of like, I'm exactly where I need to be, but I just can't find the person I'm looking for. I sometimes wonder if is the thing you need to let go of is having a relationship itself, because it seems like you're disqualifying literally everyone. So if that's the case, then maybe it's relationships itself that you actually have beef with, not with other human beings. So that's the first thing, is figure out whether or not you actually want a relationship and you're actually looking for somebody to have a really strong, beautiful pair bond partnership with. Or if you think you're supposed to want a relationship and this laundry list of requirements are actually your shield against building it. And I think when people have this idea that they're just looking for the right person and they don't have to do any work on themselves at all, I think the other piece of it is that the relationship itself is a marker of how they've arrived. Like sometimes the relationship isn't about like having that beautiful love story. It's more that if they catch the person that matches all of their criteria, that is a symbol that they themselves have arrived. So it's not an assumption that they've arrived. It's that they're looking for something that will tell them that they've arrived. And so they're using an external marker for their own personal development. And that never works out. That never works out. If you got the person you think you want, within a very short amount of time, they would look at you and say, okay, now you got to catch up to where I'm at. The marker wouldn't be you've arrived. The marker would be, here's a mirror to all the work you haven't been doing so far. And so you're going to get that mirror back anyway. And maybe it won't be like, maybe you, because you've been putting off acknowledging the work you need to do, maybe you've been putting that off so long that if you found that person and they started to mirror back the work you now need to do to catch up to them, that would be just as offensive, and then you would have a terrible relationship with them because your ego would be, you know, get triggered all over the place. So kind of be careful what you wish for. If you got that thing that told you arrived, it wouldn't tell you you've arrived, because nothing can tell you you've arrived. The only thing you can do is become an increasingly better human being. And that's why it's becoming the right person, not finding the right person.
There's different aspects of this too. I think in terms of there is growth that can happen in a relationship that cannot happen outside of a relationship. When you're in a romantic relationship, you have an opportunity to grow aspects of yourself and together as a couple, but individually, just taking it from your side, you're listening right now, if you're in a relationship, you have possibility to grow together with the person you're in a relationship with, or more importantly, you have the ability to use that relationship like Antonio's talking about, where there's mirroring things back to you. You can get feedback. It's an incredible feedback loop at a very deep and intimate level. And that's really powerful. If you're with somebody that can, even if they're not committed to personal growth like you might be, even if they're not interested in personality typology or models and systems thinking, maybe they're just the person you're in a relationship with that isn't interested in this particular type of thing. It doesn't mean that you can't still use that relationship in a way to help you grow there in that space. And I would also say that there's growth you can do when you're not in a relationship that you can't do in a relationship. There's personal growth that you have to do when you're either single or you're not with that person. Like maybe you spend some time apart just for short periods of time, or you're single for a period of time. There's growth that can happen that can't happen in a relationship. So there's some possibility of becoming the right person, becoming that amazing person that will attract the amazing person in your life. There's context for you to be able to become more of that person in relationships and become more of that person outside of relationships. And I think those are two different contexts for being able to develop yourself. And if you're in a relationship and you never had the time outside of the relationship, you might have to make a little bit of space, maybe nothing like extreme. Like it's not like leave your partner for 6 months and go out and, you know, find yourself, but it might be, you know, you just take a 4-day retreat by yourself somewhere to a foreign city to think in terms of what things are for you, you know, just for you, and growing in that way to come back into the relationship more empowered and growing through that. And there's all sorts of different, probably creative things particular to your context as you listen that you can think about. But just think about those two frameworks. Is there's probably growth that happens in the relationship and growth that happens outside of it. And depending on where you're at, wherever you're at, if you're in a relationship, use the feedback of the relationship right now. If you're out of the relationship, use your singleness right now. Don't rush into another relationship, because there's all sorts of things you can learn while you're single about yourself that when you get back together with another person, you're going to be only, you have grown yourself in a way that you're going to be more attractive and more connected to them.
So basically you're saying that becoming Mr. or Miss Right is actually a perpetual process.
Well, of course.
Yeah.
You check a bunch of boxes and it's like, okay, now I'm Mr. Right. ladies.
And the concept of it not ending, because we love personal development. And we think personal development happens in perpetuity. And that means that you're not just becoming an amazing person in order to attract somebody. That's one of the emergence that happens. That's like one of the side benefits that happens. And when you enter a relationship with them, you're not complete. And they haven't necessarily, I mean, I know that there's a concept that our spouses complete us, and there is some truth to that. And then also, we've never arrived. The work is always there waiting for us to continue to work on who we are. So becoming the right person for our spouse is something that keeps going after a commitment is made. We continually become a better version of ourselves in behalf of both ourselves and our spouse. So it's not even so much about becoming the right person in order to accomplish a goal. It's about becoming, you know, like to nail or to land that amazing human being. Like that, I think that's one of the reasons why people will say things like, well, when I stopped looking, they showed up. It's not because you weren't open to the possibility, and it's not because the universe has a wicked sense of humor, even though it might. It's more that when you stop focusing so hard on finding that person, you're now focused on who you are, and you just kind of naturally start to blossom and emerge as a better human being, and now you're super attractive. And now the kind of person you want to attract is becoming attracted to you. And so it's less about finding that person and catching them than it is about becoming a magnet for that person. They'll find you. They'll spot you across the room. They'll come. They won't be able to help themselves because you've become such an attractive version of yourself. And again, a lot of it is giving yourself permission to find what you find attractive. You know, Joel was talking earlier about you want to find the highest quality spouse, right? The highest quality person, the best match. And all of those words are totally subjective and contextual to who you are as an individual. The best match, the most attractive, the highest quality person for you might be a terrible person for someone else. They might be very low quality for that person. Not low quality because they're a low quality human, but low quality because the match itself would not be good. And so it would bring everything down. So again, these are all subjective indicators, and only you will know that. However, when you are in a space where you are ready to be attractive and attracted, then when you create these requirements, you have to make sure that you are matching them yourself. If you want somebody who is an empowered human being, who doesn't let the world drag you down, and you want somebody who's, say, out of the drama triangle, a model we talked about a lot, right, where everybody fulfills some role of victim, villain, or hero. Well, if you want somebody who's in the empowerment dynamic, who sees themselves as a creator and doesn't get trapped in the drama triangle, you need to make sure you are vigilant about staying in the empowerment dynamic. You need to be an empowered person. You need to recognize that you create your reality. So any requirement we place on somebody else, we have to be vigilant about keeping those requirements ourselves. If you require somebody to be of a certain physical stamina, or that there's somebody who works out a lot and, you know, keeps their body in a really high level of health, in your opinion, you need to be matching that yourself. All of the requirements that you're projecting onto somebody else, it's unfair of you to ask another person to have accomplished them if you are unwilling to do that on your own. And that includes things like status and resource. If you want somebody who's high status and has gained, like maybe gained a lot of resource, if you have not done that yourself, it's kind of hard to ask another person to do that in your behalf and that you ride on their coattails. Like, are you looking for a love relationship is looking for a peer relationship. And that doesn't mean necessarily you have to be, like, if you find somebody or meet somebody who's a self-made millionaire, you have to have done that. But whatever is your subjective experience of accomplishment, like however you gauge it, it's not very helpful to enter a relationship if you think somebody else is outclassing you in those. You need to have sort of a balanced interpretation of your accomplishments so that you can respect each other on that level.
The principle of what we're talking about is shifting from an outcome frame, a results-based frame, to a process-based frame. So we talk about becoming Mr. Right or becoming Miss Right. We don't talk about being those things because you can never fully be something if you're always emerging toward that thing. So we're talking about the process that you're going through, and you're going to be at a different stage of that. And again, it matters whatever quote unquote being Mr. Right or Miss Right is to you. That's subjective as well. Whatever that means to you, I have a very clear picture in my head what it means for me to become Mr. Right in that, you know, I have markers that I'm looking toward to grow myself in, and that's subjective to me, and you have that as well. But the point is that I'm working on it. I'm continually refining that. It's process focused, and I think that's really key, because even you have the relationship that comes into your life, the work doesn't stop. In fact, some would argue that's really when the real work begins. You end up in a long-term relationship. You know, you want to talk about hard work. You think right now, maybe you're not in a relationship. You haven't been in a really long-term committed relationship. You've casually dated a few times, or maybe you're just starting out dating and you're like, man, this seems like so much hard work to find the right person and to become this person that can attract that person and all that. Wait till you get in the relationship. That actually, to some degree, is a little easier in a lot of ways to finding people than it is to working through issues in relationship, all the challenges that come up. And wait till you mix in things like in-laws and children, and the relationship starts to have more complications, and you're getting older, and you've got infrastructure, and you've got commitments, and your finances are tied together. There's a lot of things that come with long-term relationships that, as you become a better person through the experience, you're going to be equipped to deal with all those challenges. And that's really, again, you don't think in terms, especially when you're young, when you're looking for that pair bond partner, it's sometimes hard to think down the road of all the things that are coming for you. And the going is going to get tougher. And that's why starting now, especially if you're young, is so powerful. Start becoming that person that you want to try to attract, because now it's a discipline, it's process focused, it's going to last you a lifetime. It's not going to just end at the altar or when you finally get into the relationship or you move in together. It's something you're going to continue throughout your entire life. So I think that's our message to you, is the principle is the process, not the result. And the result's almost an emergence of really refined processes. We talk about this a lot here at Personality Hacker, is that if you're process-oriented, your results typically over time get better and better if you're improving the process along the way. So what do you think? What kind of relationships have you been in? What is this story for you? Do you feel like you're working on yourself and you're attracting people? Have you done that and it's still not working out? You're still attracting losers into your life and you're like, why is this not? I feel like I'm working on myself, Joel and Antonia. I've been listening to Personality Hacker for 4 years and I've implemented this stuff and it's still a disaster in my dating life. And bring your story. Come and make a comment under this podcast. Let's get the community involved. Let's get other people of like minds to share ideas, to cross-pollinate your stories together. And let's see if we can find some advice, some triangulation, some help here. We have a powerful community of like minds. Come join with us and be a part of this community. It's powerful for you and we need your voice represented here. You can also join our community of like minds over at facebook.com/personalityhacker or twitter.com/personalityhack.
Yeah, if you're single still and you've been working on yourself, don't take what we said as like law that you haven't, quote unquote, you're like not at that level. Sometimes people are just in the wrong place at the wrong time. That also happens. But you increase your odds when you become a magnet.
See, everything we say is principles, not necessarily rules or things you have to do. These are more principles and ways of seeing the world.
Yeah, exactly. So don't think we're like somehow like rubber stamping you as unqualified. Please don't take that message. That said, if you enjoyed this podcast, you can subscribe to us on iTunes and various Android platforms. And if you're feeling particularly giving and you're not upset because you think we just called you a horrible person, you can leave a rating review on iTunes. It helps us out a lot.
My name is Joel Mark Witt.
And I'm Antonia Dodge.
And we'll talk with you on the next Personality Hacker Podcast.